So hello, good afternoon. Welcome to the Open Education Network Summit. Thank you for joining us for today's session on Centering Social Justice in Open Education, the Certificate in Open Educational Practices. My name is Tanya Grosz, and I'm the Director of Educational Programs for the Open Ed Network. We are delighted to have you here today, and we thank you for the work that each of you in our community do to make education more equitable, accessible, and affordable through open education. Before we begin, the OEN is housed at the University of Minnesota Twin Cities, which is located on traditional, ancestral, and contemporary lands of Indigenous people. The university resides in Dakota land ceded in the treaties of 1837 and 1851. We acknowledge this place has a complex and layered history. This land acknowledgement is just one of the ways in which we work to educate the campus and community about this land and our relationships with it and each other. We are committed to ongoing efforts to recognize, support, and advocate for American Indian nations and peoples, and we thank the Dakota people for their persistence through a violent history. Please feel free to acknowledge the Indigenous people to whom the land you are situated on belongs in the chat if you're so inclined. As mentioned during the summit kickoff yesterday, each of our summit session relates back to one of the OEN's strategic planning action pathways. This particular session relates back to the open pedagogy pathway. And as we begin the session, we'd like to share a few important details with you. This session is being recorded, and for that reason, you've been muted. The video transcripts and slides will be sent to all attendees and to the OEN Google group after the summit has concluded. Videos will also be posted on the Community Hub. We are committed to providing a friendly, safe, and welcoming environment for all attendees. You can learn more about our community norms at z.umn.edu/summit-community-norms. Please join us in creating a safe and constructive space. And the hashtag for the summit is #OENSummit22. Please feel free to join us on Twitter at @OpenEd_network. Also, if you'd like to ask questions, please use the Q&A function of this session. So today we're gonna introduce our team. We're gonna talk about the grant that we were awarded and a programmatic overview, foundations of the online course we have created. We're gonna delve a little bit into why open pedagogy, why open educational practices, talk about how and ways in which we centered social justice. Racheal is going to talk about the course and instructional design process, which was a very thoughtful and intentional one. Talk about next steps briefly and take any questions you might have. So to introduce our team, now this isn't the whole team, this is just who's here presenting today. We have Racheal Brooks, North Carolina Central University, who's the Director of E-Learning. Miceli Cawdery from the University of Hawaii System at Leeward Community College. He's a professor and the Teacher Education Program Coordinator. Will Cross from North Carolina State University, who is the Director of the Open Knowledge Center and Head of Information Policy. And Heather Miceli from Roger Williams University, who is a lecturer and general education. I want to talk to you a little bit about the fabulous grant that we were awarded, and then we'll move on to programmatic overview. We're so thankful to the Institute of Museum and Library Services, IMLS. When Heather, Lindsay Gum, and Will wrote this grant, they did so realizing that academic librarians are often being asked to lead faculty in the exploration and implementation of open educational practices. At the same time, faculty may not know whom to turn to for help when transforming learning through the use of open educational practices. For those reasons, they wrote the grant proposal with faculty and librarian teams in mind. Funded by a generous grant from IMLS, we developed a blueprint for equitable open educational practices and are piloting a training program this fall that prepares librarians and faculty to serve as partners for these efforts. We created actionable pathways for librarians and faculty to collaborate to make education more equitable, inclusive, and sustainable. I want to tell you a little about the research stream. So Lindsay, Heather, and Will began with a broad series of interviews, surveys, and focus groups with leaders and practitioners from a diverse set of institutions and intersectional identities about how faculty can and do support and center student agency in their open educational practices. Their research informed the development of this program and will be ongoing as the Certificate in Open Educational Practices progresses. We spent a long time working on the creation of an online course, and basically the end of that, the culminating project, will be a customized action plan. So this 8-week online course contains foundational issues in open educational practices as rooted in the principles of social justice. The course will be taken by faculty librarian teams and will be facilitated by myself, Michael Cawdery, Will Cross, Lindsay Gum, and Heather Miceli. Our goal is to equip both the librarian and the instructor with the knowledge and the tools to be able to go back to their institution and help others implement open educational practices. We intentionally set up the program for instructor and librarian teams because it addresses a common refrain we hear from faculty: I wasn't sure who to ask for help. Also, the different roles are necessary and complementary. There's emphasis on pedagogy, but also there's a compelling need to understand FERPA and copyright. Also, we're striving to create a community of practice that extends into each individual institution. And likely in the future, we're hoping that the program will expand to other faculty support roles, instructional designers, CTL managers, that type of thing. There is a practicum action plan that is the culminating project. And so the teams are working together. We've chunked pieces of it out during the online course. And then, you know, it could be a lesson plan, it could be a unit, a syllabus, you know, anything that can be transformed through open educational practice. But it's really meant to harness also the power of open pedagogy and to invite students into the whole system to be co-creators of knowledge. And they are doing this with the full support of the 5 facilitators, as well as their cohort and their partner. Now I'm going to turn it over to Michael to address some foundations.
Hi, all. Apologies. My video, for whatever reason, it has been turned off. So I'm not sure, but I'm happy to continue to, there we go, I'm back. Hi, everybody. Sure, I don't have control over the screen. Am I meant to?
Just let me know, Michael, and I'll advance the slides.
Sure, please do. I don't think, you know, the idea of sharing with you sort of the foundations of where we are and how we're approaching this is not, I have a friend who'd like to join us. Sorry, I'm doing daddy daycare at the moment. It's not to sort of, you know, overwhelm you with something that is overly complex or academic in nature, but rather to kind of, you know, communicate to you all that we're very much focused on the evolving nature of open education, both practices and pedagogy, as it's sort of changing with it over the last 10 to 12, 15, 20 years as online education has evolved. And in particular, focusing on the practices and creating access and encouraging social justice as we engage in those practices. And if you can advance, thanks. So I think many of you are probably familiar with sort of open ed and OER and sort of the evolution, perhaps from the beginning of Wiley, when you know, academic higher education pedagogical practices were sort of changing, but primarily focused on assessments and thinking about how we can change our practices. Wiley focused on being able to reuse, retain, revise, but was primarily focused on renewable assignments or renewable assessments. And then I think Zhang Jiani and DeRosa sort of are helping, you know, all of us to sort of understand the evolution of the pedagogical practices in the online space or in higher ed or as individuals who are practicing or instructors who are practicing open education pedagogy and open education practices. I think, but these are just on a sort of continuum. I think what a lot of open educators are encouraging all of us to do is kind of re-envision, reimagine, retool. We could probably go on about what the evolution of the change of the practice is as we have sort of evolved in the online space and increased access to a variety of people as a result of the sort of the wide cast of the online space. But I think it's just really to ask us to continue to explore and examine what it is that we're doing and increase opportunities for social justice within higher ed and instructional practices.
Thank you, Michael. And I think I'm jumping in next. And thank you, Tanya, for running the slides. I appreciate you taking on that labor. So I think my job here quickly is to talk to you about the way that we see open pedagogy and social justice as a clear match and a natural partnership for one another. I think we recognize that justice is baked into the core mission of OEP, these themes of connection, of building community, and of genuine and complete access and co-creation are what makes open pedagogy and open educational practices open. And those are very much in the heart of what we talk about when we talk about justice and inclusion as well. And I want to sort of make two quick points on that in particular. The first on the next slide is that we recognize that OEP is a practice engaged with providing agency and making things better in concrete ways. When we talk about renewable assignments as better than the sort of intellectual stairmasters that some of us might have inherited, that's not just a move away from the banking model of sort of expertise being transferred to other people, but it's, I think, at its highest purpose, a move away from the presumed and enforced hierarchies and instead centers the lived experiences of all the learners that are participating in that work. And I'll go on the next slide to say a little more about this idea that openness is in designed to be inclusive and engaged with the existing inequities that exist in the world, that open pedagogy in particular really lives and dies by a clear-eyed view about addressing the things that need to be made better and more open and more inclusive for others. Jasmine shared a quote this morning, the freedom to exercise one's full humanity, and that's open pedagogy and open educational practices to me, is you can bring your whole authentic self into the work and do work that's meaningful in that context. So on the next slide, I think we just want to say that we see these as sort of a match made perfectly for one another, and we were really excited to bring these two great tastes that taste great together to do this work. And I think that's my cue to hush up and turn it over to Heather.
Thanks, Will. So I'm going to be talking about how we deliberately centered social justice in our team building, in our course development, and moving forward. And we have some artifacts and resources that we're going to share. And I think Tanya is going to be popping some of the links into the chat as I'm going through. I also want to acknowledge that we as a team benefited greatly from Jasmine's expertise in this area. And so I'm going to mention her a couple of times as people have saw her talk this morning. So if you go ahead and go on to the next slide, Tanya. I need to advance my slide, sorry, so that I can see my notes. All right. So in our early meetings with our core team, we realized the importance of having some sort of document that we should refer to should conflict arise among our members. And so we decided, and Jasmine had recommended, to create a work agreement. Our group was composed of some people that had worked together for several years at this point, and others were brand new to the group. So we wanted to take some deliberate time to outline our expectations for and wishes for the group and how we would work together and how we would address issues if they came up within the group. So the link is here, and I'm sure Tanya has put it into the chat. We also used this space to define some specific terms that we were using throughout the project, such as what does open educational practices mean? What do we mean when we say open pedagogy? What are we talking about when we actually use the word equity or social justice? And we kept a shortened draft of our project in timeline to keep us on task. And if you actually read that work agreement, you'll see that we had some very ambitious goals to create this course in the fall and have kind of skewed a little off course, but we're on track now. Next slide, Tanya. Then our next task was to assemble a group of practitioners that would comprise our curriculum design team. As we curated our team, we were cognizant of our need to be inclusive and diverse. Jasmine really pushed us to think about diversities in factors beyond race. So we thought about region, institutional type, gender, special area, or role, and disabilities. And so here is the final curriculum design team. There were 8 of us, including Racheal, Michael, Will, me, and Tanya. And we also included in this team was Hannah Davidson from Plymouth State University. She was our accessibility specialist. Lindsay Gum from Roger Williams University, who is a librarian and an open ped expert. And Jasmine Roberts-Cruz from Ohio State as our social justice specialist. And you can see those of us who will be facilitating the course in the fall, indicated by the facilitator role. And each one of us had a very specific role that we were playing on this team, while also, you know, contributing to the curriculum as a whole. And so, Tanya, if you want to switch to the next slide. One of the major frameworks that we used while developing this curriculum was Lambert's Social Justice Framework for Open Education, which, if you're unfamiliar with, it's outlined in this slide. Lambert focuses on 3 principles of social justice: redistributive, so equal access to course materials; recognitive justice, so this is including social cultural diversity materials, a diversity of perspectives, and the centering of marginalized experiences; as well as representational justice, giving people power and authority and authorship and co-construction of their own materials. This framework we used to create the course. We were very deliberate about identifying areas within the course where each of these principles was addressed. And at the same time, it's actually referenced several times throughout the course for our participants to ensure that they are also considering these principles as they go through and create their OEP projects in their action plan. Next slide, Tanya. Once the course curriculum was nearly completed, each of us engaged in completing this survey developed by Title Equity. Title Equity is a strategy firm that's solving the problem of inequality at scale. But these 7 questions really made us think about the course as now that it is almost fully developed, to identify gaps, places where maybe we need to identify places we need to identify to add more material or more inclusive material or ways to increase the equity. Each one of us addressed the 7 questions after we reviewed the course, and we identified areas where equity could be better addressed, who might be excluded from our course, and are currently challenging ourselves to think about how we could improve the course further. And then the next thing we will be using, we're not quite there yet, but we plan to use additional rubrics to evaluate the course and the curriculum, such as Peralta Community College's online equity rubric. They created this rubric to aid in institutionalizing practices that support inclusion and equity in online environments, something that many institutions struggle with. So we're going to tap into this resource to make sure that our course is equitable and accessible to all of our participants. And we will also be using the equity in OR rubric that is also linked there. And to kind of wrap up this section, While we've attempted to center social justice as much as we can on the front end of this project, we realize that we are only 8 voices in the vast ocean of open educators. And it's our plan to solicit detailed feedback from our participants and use that to modify the course as necessary for future iterations. Next slide. So I'm going to just start off this section and then pass it on to Racheal, who's going to get into the nitty-gritty of how we did our curriculum design. As our team, our first task was to outline the various learning objectives we wished for our participants to walk away from the course having learned. This was a pretty extensive list, but after a lot of modification, condensation, and editing, we ultimately could fit our learning objectives into 6 modules listed here on the screen. Each of the modules is 1 to 2 weeks in length, depending on the amount and depth of the learning activities we've developed. And as you can see, we have the what, the why, and the how. So our first 2 modules are basically introducing our participants to open education and open educational practices. There is somewhat of an assumption that most of the individuals that will be taking this course at least have a basis in open education or OER, but we wanted to make sure that everyone was starting on the same page. So we have a short introductory module on open education, and then another module specifically dedicated to conversations about what open educational practices are. Module number 3 goes into some critical considerations of open educational practices, starting to talk about equity and inclusion and who is open actually for and who is included in open. And then modules 4, 5, and 6 are to help our participants with actually taking their OEP ideas and putting them into classroom practice. So number 4 is accessibility, number 5 is student empowerment, and number 6 is applied OEP. And with that, I'm going to pass it on to Racheal, who's going to talk about how we did all of this.
Thank you for that exceptional foundation and introduction, Heather. So I am really excited to share with you all the work that this team has been doing in creating the actual course content. They have put in a tremendous amount of very intentional planning and course development to create a comprehensive experience for those of you who are going to be taking this course. As you are thinking about the incorporation of open education, the use of open educational resources in the development of your work to promote social justice. And so the way that the team went about doing this was through very intentional curriculum design. Here on the screen, we have 2 of the tools that were frequently utilized to help organize the content in the course and to create this cohesive experience. The first one being the module mapping matrix, which we will take a very quick look at and explore the components of that and how it was utilized to create and ensure alignment throughout the course modules, as well as the transparent learning activity sheet. So this was a tool that we utilized, and again, we'll take a closer look at it in subsequent slides, that allowed us to ensure that the various course components and items that should be associated with each learning activity to help you as the participants be successful in navigating through each activity were present. So we're going to explore that. And first, we're going to delve into the module mapping matrix. So as you can see, we do reference the fact that we considered alignment as it relates to the definition provided by Quality Matters. Now, we utilize Quality Matters as our quality benchmark in the creation of this course, but we do encourage and we also acknowledge that many campuses will find, and many of you who are engaging in your different initiatives and your different projects may utilize other types of quality benchmarks. This is the one that we selected through our experience and familiarity with it, but you may choose to use, for example, the OLC quality scorecard. You might use, you know, the rubric, Blackboard's exemplary course rubric, but we decided to utilize Quality Matters. And so in the context of our work, I'm just going to share a little bit more about that. So as it relates to ensuring you have objectives that are clear and measurable, both at that course level and within each of the modules, this is how our team went about doing so. So in the creation of it, not only were we intentional about making sure that those who are going to be participating in this had very clear expectations regarding the course components and how they're aligned, but also how they will support the achievement of the objectives for each of the modules and ultimately for the course. In the creation of your own content, it's helpful to even think about how these objectives at the course and module level can support pluralistic education. And so as both Will and Heather had pointed out, not only in the creation of the course did we provide instructions or feedback for how to do this in your own content that you might create, but we decided to develop a course that led by example. And so we hope that this is something you will see throughout. Now on the next slide, we talk about the importance of having assessment instruments, creating them in the course that was developed, as well as encouraging faculty and librarian teams in the creation of their own content to think about how assessments can empower learners by providing multiple opportunities and ways in which they can not only engage in voice and choice, but also demonstrate their acquisition of these skills in ways that celebrate their ethnocultural identities, such as engaging in collaborative and cooperative learning. Now, on the next slide, we look deeper at the instructional materials and the learning activities that were selected. You will find throughout this course that the instructional materials that were curated, these open educational resources that were selected, were done so thinking very intentionally about the various backgrounds of our participants, and also providing that example for the creation of your own content by thinking about who are your learners, what are their backgrounds, what are they bringing to the table, and how can they see their future successful selves represented in the experts who are selected as scholars and successful individuals in the field. We also encourage, as it relates to the learning activities, engagement and voice and choice, and the sharing of perspectives through engagement throughout the course. You will find representative exemplars as far as the texts. We encourage the selection of guest speakers who are from a variety of backgrounds and perspectives, emphasizing the importance of social justice. And on the final slide that kind of breaks down how we mapped out this alignment, we thought about the selection of technology, the accessibility of that technology and the use of it, making sure that it supports ease of use, that it is something that provides opportunities for authentic communication and supports a caring learner to instructor, and in this case, participant to facilitator experience. And so this just provides kind of a comprehensive overview of how we went about aligning elements that are found in this course and the suggestions that you will find within the course regarding the creation of your own content. Now, moving on to the next slide, we have a deeper exploration of the process itself, and you'll see that it is broken down into three main categories. The process by which we created the course content, our intentionality as it relates to transparency, and the application of that matrix. And so we have this broken down into a process that incorporated four phases. The development of the course and module level objectives. First of all, understanding what it is that we wanted to do and what the expectations were for those who are participating in this course to be able to do upon their successful completion of it, as well as a second phase, which dealt with the creation of aligned assessments, instructional materials, and those learning activities that we just discussed. We then went into a third phase, where we really focused on the development of a prototype module, where we collaboratively worked together to create and come to agreement regarding the organization of the modules, as well as the type of content, and even the tone of the language that came across in the presentation of the content within the modules. And then in the fourth phase, we cooperatively developed the rest of the modules and the supplementary items that are found throughout the course. You have an image on the screen right now that provides an overview of that process in much more detail, but it really demonstrates how we went about this in a very collaborative manner, thinking about the roles and responsibilities of each individual and being intentional about how we could divide the work and simultaneously collaboratively work together to efficiently create the course content. Now, on the next slide, we look at the transparency of the process, where we thought about how are we going to ensure that the various components within each activity were present to support the success of those who are participating in the course. You'll see that each of these, we utilize these learning activity sheets, these transparent learning activity sheets, to help us clarify the various components of each of those activities. Starting out, of course, with the title, the objectives of the activities and how they align with the overall objectives for that respective module. A very intentional description and identification of the purpose of the activity, as well as step-by-step directions for how our participants would complete each of the activities. If you advance just a little bit further, we will see some other components that came into alignment with the creation of each of these activities, which incorporated the assessment, not only potentially the assessment instrument, for example, in the case in which we might have utilized a rubric, but also what were our plans for providing feedback to those participants? And we intentionally indicated what are the materials or the technology that would be needed for the successful completion of that activity. And on the next slide, we have information regarding the application of the matrix. If you could step back just one click. There we go. Excellent. Thank you. And so here we have an example of the structure of each of the modules. To the far right of the slide, you will see that each module begins with a module overview page. Now, this page provides not only a narrative introduction, but an introduction that is meant to be personable, is meant to connect prior knowledge with the current information that is covered in the module, and to prepare each of the participants for what is to come in subsequent modules. It also includes a listing of the module objectives. And so here you see the application of that module mapping matrix, where we identified what exactly are the objectives of that module. They are written in measurable terms that describe behaviors that are observable so that our participants understand. By the time we complete module one, we should be able to articulate a definition of open educational resources, as well as the continuing six objectives. There are also within the module instructional materials that include open textbook selections, websites, video resources, and other applicable open educational resources that tap directly into that social justice aspect. And within the module, our participants will find learning activities as well as assessments that can be both formative and used as learning opportunities, as well as summative assessments. And we heavily emphasize the collaborative nature of the activities across our faculty as well as our librarian teams. On the final slide that I'd like to share with you, you'll see a deeper dive into that module mapping matrix as it relates to the actual activities or assessments that are presented within the course. So here you can see an example of two of the activities from the first module, one dealing with a discussion and the second dealing with an action plan planning document. We can see the alignment of each of these assessments or activities, depending on type, with the overall objective of the course, as well as the relevant module level objectives within module one. We can also see very clearly what are the instructional materials that are necessary for participants to be able to engage with content, to be able to successfully complete that activity, as well as the anticipated technology that will be utilized. And this allowed us to be able to go into the learning management system that we were utilizing. We're using the Canvas learning management system to create the applicable activities, as well as ensuring that they are populated correctly within Canvas. Now, culminating this whole process, what we did was perform a pre-delivery assessment where we were able to go through each of the modules and identify, based on these alignment sheets, what items were present, what might have been missing, where there were opportunities for enhancement. And as was shared earlier, we utilized the information that we gained from the questionnaire regarding the title equality questionnaire that applied equity sequence questions. They helped us to identify where were those elements where we could enhance the content that's currently present in the course to ensure a comprehensive and meaningful experience for all of those who are participating. So I will now turn this over to my colleague, Michael, to bring us home. There we go.
Sure. I think we were just sort of, wanted to take an opportunity to kind of get an idea of some of the approaches or tools or, any of the various strategies that you all are using to center social justice in your practice. You have a QR code here, as well as a link to a Mentimeter. And if you could just take a second and just sort of use that and fill in, and then we'll share a little results and just sort of broaden our horizons a little bit with everybody's input. So we see a few starting to populate now. And feel free to use the chat function too, if that is sort of easier, or if you run into any sort of headaches or hassles with the QR code or the Mentimeter. And Tanya, there is the, in the next slide, if we can share the results in the chat, I guess. Oh, there we go. Awesome. Thanks, Will, for sharing the link in the chat as well. And you can go ahead and view the Mentimeter results as well. And so we have folks are chiming in with involving students in content creation, co-created student policies, obviously in the sort of classroom management, classroom culture sort of realm, using a wide diversity of examples within coursework, changing up subject matter. I mean, it's certainly, the work that we're doing here is a part of a larger effort within higher ed and academia to, push the boundaries a little bit in subject matter that has been traditionally taught in sort of very common ways over the past 100 years. And, as access has increased and diversity has increased and our value systems and value structures have changed over the past 20, 30, 40, 50 years, subject matter itself is changing. I mean, access to information on the web or even within higher ed and research is changing. Ensuring a diversity of voices, working directly with experts. I like the example someone shared, working with the accessibility office, working with instructional designers, working with accessibility offices. Obviously, as you can listen to the way in which Racheal articulates the work that we're doing, the experts are the folks who we as faculty or instructors can rely on. And it's incredible, the sort of practice and knowledge and experiences that designers, instructional designers, design teams, accessibility offices, DEI initiative officers, and so on and so forth carry with them and are sort of wanting to contribute to instructors' classrooms, which I think is quite significant of a change for higher education, letting people into your classroom, having that diverse, those diverse voices. And so again, you have the results there if you just want to continue to explore, and I will pass. And thank you very much for your sharing your thoughts regarding different approaches, practices that we're using to sort of change our practices. I'll pass it back to Tanya, and thank you all.
Thanks, Michael. So we hope that you will consider applying for our certificate in open educational practices. The application deadline is August 5th, and we are looking for instructor librarian teams. While we do think we'll probably open it up beyond instructor librarian teams in the future, that's what we're doing for this pilot. We're looking for 15 pairs. The applications are streaming in, so if you are thinking about it, please get that in as soon as you can. So thank you today. Thank you, audience. Before I turn it over and we deal with some Q&A, thank you for joining us today in the conversation around our strategic planning action pathways. As we move forward with building out each pathway, we invite you to share related projects that you may be working on or ideas that the related summit session sparked for you on the summit community share document that I'll drop in the chat in just a second. We also encourage you to keep the conversation going about today's session in the OEN Google group. And we want to remind you that today's session has been recorded and will be shared with you via email and posted on the Community Hub in the coming weeks. Slides and transcripts will also be linked. So I think you can ask us questions via the Q&A or the chat if you'd like. So does anybody have any questions?
So I see there's a question about overlap between this and the previous certificate. And I'll say I think we benefited from having several instructors who participated in developing the previous certificate in this group as well. I'll speak for myself and I'll be curious what others think as well. I think the intention is that there should be a pretty direct link that if you finish the certificate in OER librarianship, this is sort of a specialization or like, I've laid my foundation. This is the branch I'm excited and exploring next. So it shouldn't be duplicative. You shouldn't have a sense that, okay, I've already done that. I hope that the certificate in OER librarianship is a perfect sort of setup to take this step and think about practices as well. Does that resonate for other people, or are there nuances you want to add?
I think that's good. Someone asked in the chat, in case you didn't see it, is there a cost for this program? There is no cost for this pilot program. So for this pilot offering, the OEN is planning to offer it every year annually, but there's no cost this time. And we've always done our best to keep costs affordable and to give partial scholarships and full scholarships. So we will continue to do that. And we're committed to being as inclusive as we can. No cost for this pilot project or the pilot offering. And someone else asked, do we both have to apply or can we just submit one application? And you do both need to submit applications, both the instructor and the librarian. So thank you for those questions. Someone has asked for the page that describes the program, and I will get that as soon as I can. In writing applications, we should emphasize how we would apply social justice practices while using OER in our class. There's very specific questions on the application. And so one does ask about your interest in diversity and social justice. So the questions should be able to guide very much your responses. And it's not, I hope it's not an onerous application.
There's a question in chat about how many semesters might faculty expect to develop open resources. I'll say the question mentions a textbook, and certainly creating a textbook is one really cool thing you can do with OEP, but there are a lot of other things that we hope folks will be prepared to do as well, because I think what I hear in the question is like, it takes a long time to write a textbook. So there are plenty of open interventions that are, I want to dip my toe in the water as opposed to I'm going to do a flying cannonball in. But I think the timeline we're imagining is in the fall, we'll lay the foundation. In the spring, folks will sort of try it out. Well, they'll bring some initial open interventions in. I hope it'll be wildly successful and it'll just be a thing they do going forward because it's the norm to do it. But that's going to vary, I think, for different people. And I'm talking a lot, so I hope other people will jump in too.
No, I was going to say the same thing, Will. I mean, I think this is designed to help people dip their toe in, jump in the deep end, whichever you want to do, but have been stymied because of some barrier. And we're trying to kind of ease those barriers and give people kind of like just a place to ask questions and get some information from other people. And so, like Will said, you know, in the fall we'll have the course, and then hopefully in the spring you're actually putting your action plan into action, and hopefully you'll notice that yes, OEP tends to need more than one semester to kind of get off the ground. For me, any teaching intervention ultimately needs another semester attempt because there's always something that needs to be changed. And so we hope to like create, as Tanya said, a community of practice to help network people so that when you do have a situation like, oh, I have this open textbook and I can't find the end of it, how do you find the end of it, right? Or how do I keep it going for multiple semesters? And the goal here is not just to train people in open educational practices, but to develop a really helpful professional network of open educators doing open educational practices in their classroom.
Any other questions before we wrap up? Thank you for these wonderful questions. Very thoughtful. Okay, then with that, we will say have a good afternoon, and please join us tomorrow for the continuation of the summit. Thanks, everyone. Thank you to my co-presenters.
Thanks, everybody. We're so excited about this.
We are. It's going to be a lot of fun, and you always learn so much during a pilot. So we're very excited.